Amen. Praise the Lord, everyone. Thank you on behalf of my stepmother, Sherry, my sisters, Angela, Jonna, and our extended family. Thank you so much for being here. I know for some it was a tough drive, and who would have thought we would have had a winter storm on this day, but I am thankful. I'm thankful for all the help we had getting everything set up. And for everybody that's on the platform here today, we're gonna do everything just kind of run smoothly after I'm done here, and I'm not gonna come back up and introduce everybody. But I will say it is good to have my brother-in-law here, and it's good to have Brother Chapman here. It's good to have our district superintendent, Brother McLaughlin, with us, and it's good to have Brother Buster, and he will be bringing the message to us today. I got a lot of stories, and probably mostly everybody in this room has a lot of stories about Dad. And I could tell you a lot of funny stories, but I think I'm going to keep it a little serious. And then I'm just going to get out of the way. There's two that really, really come to my mind. And most, unless you're part of this local congregation, most don't know this about me. But I grew up in the church and fell out of the church at a young age, about 12 years old, and turned to drugs and turned to alcohol and lived the life of an addict for 12 or 13 years. And I was living in St. John, New Brunswick, where I was born. And Dad at that time was in St. Catharines, and he was always trying to get me to go down and visit him. And I would never go. And this one time he said, "I've got work for you." Well, when you're an addict, money is important. And so I flew down to St. Catharines and I worked for a few days, and that's all I could handle. And I went back. But as I was leaving the airport, I'd already gone through the gate and said our goodbyes. And I heard her dad call my name. And he said, "Jamie." And if you know him, he'd get all excited. "Jamie." I said, "What?" In my mind, I'm thinking, he's just going to try to save me again, he said, "All I want to say to you is if you take one step towards God, he'll do the rest." Get a little upset with him. I get on the plane and it hit me about halfway home. I'd like to say at that very moment or the next few weeks, I gave my heart to the Lord. I did it. But I never forgot. Take one step to him, and he'll do the rest. And I know that's not always the case for everybody, but I'd like to leave that with somebody. If you're struggling today, if you don't have the answer, if you can just take one step to him, he can do the rest. Amen. Amen. Last story. Over the last year and a half, or singing in the presence of Jehovah. And my brother-in-law was standing beside me, and he's a little bit better of a singer, not much, but a little better. And he started singing, and then my sister got in on it, and we begin to sing, and the presence of God fell in that room, and I feel that same presence here today. The presence of the Lord fell in that room, and he had been incoherent laying on that bed, and all of a sudden his face scrunched up like he did when he was worshiping, and his hands raised a little bit. Such a peace came in that room. And the nurses came in and the doctors, and every one of them from that moment forward for 2 weeks said, "There's such a peace I've never felt before." I'm not going to stand up here and say, if Dad were here, he would say this or he would say that. I'm not going to do that. But I will say this. If he was here, he'd be worshiping the Lord. Yes. So I'm going to ask our district superintendent, Brother McLaughlin, to come. And I know it's a celebration of life, and I know there's a lot of sadness in the room. But I'm going to ask if everybody would stand to their feet. Because I think we ought to be able to worship God. The same God that brings peace in that room. The same God that brings comfort. I don't know where everybody is this morning in your mind or in your relationship with Him. But I know you can have peace this morning, and I know you can have comfort. And I know if you take one step to Him, He'll take and do the rest. Hallelujah.
We're going to blend our voices together in prayer. I'm so thankful for that one step. That one step led to being a youth pastor, pastor here in Picton that's doing an incredible job. And Sister Angela, this is an amazing family. Jonna, when my wife and I visited Reg the last time, it was around December or January of this year. I think he knew me. And I sat there and I thought, if there's anything that Reg would like to do is talk. Yeah. You'd be hard pressed to find someone that enjoyed talking more than Reg Harwood. We're here to celebrate a life. We're here to celebrate a family. But I also believe that in this place today, it's not just happenstance that you're here. There's someone here that's going to take a step today. That's going to change the course of your life, the course of your family, your future, your destiny. Lord Jesus, we sense that we are in your presence. We thank you for the life of Reg Harwood. We thank you for Sherry.
Yeah. worship him this morning. Hallelujah, he's here right now. Lord, we lay aside every care, every weight. Hallelujah, you are touched with the feeling of our infirmities, and we're thankful for that today.
Somebody say amen. Amen. Would you just lift your hands, your voices to the Lord one more time? Let's thank the Lord. Hallelujah. For his presence, his spirit. It's here right now, God. Hallelujah. 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 Amen. My name's Michael. I'm the son-in-law, as affectionately called the man. And it was on my first visit to Elliott Lake where I asked for my wife's hand in marriage. The dad in his pickup truck looked across the seat next to me. And he said, "Well, just cut to the chase. I know why you're here." He proceeded to take me into the wilderness. I'm a city slicker. And so here we are on an island that we had to take probably a 16-hour boat ride just to get to. And at a campfire, he pulls out some baked beans and the fish that we just pulled out of the lake. And he said, "Well, do we cook these separate or do we mix them together?" And I said, "Well, let's just put them all together." He said, "Yes, because we're men." What I have come to admire about my father-in-law the most was that he had an overwhelming passion and desire to reach people for the cause of Jesus Christ. And he was an avid soul winner, something that I aspire to be more like. Dad had a way about him. He could walk in, and actually, I saw it firsthand. He came down to visit us at some point in time, and we went to Walmart, of all places, and you can just imagine Walmart and every kind of person that's there, and we are in the freezer aisle of Walmart, and I'll never forget Dad walking up to a complete, total stranger who is stocking shelves for Walmart, and instantly began to strike up a conversation and made a friend. And he said, "Hey," he came running down the aisle, "Hey, I want you to come meet my friend Bill." One thing that I know for sure is that Dad loved people just as much as the Lord. Amen. And so at this time, my wife, his daughter, is going to come and read his eulogy this morning.
Hi, everyone. He's staying right here for backup in case I start crying. But an aspect of language is when a person can define a word but has never experienced its meaning. The literary device of past, present, and future tense are considered elementary, but what do you do when the present tense phrase, "My dad is the best dad in the world," changes to the past tense phrase, "My dad was the best dad in the world"? The simple fundamental words "is" and "was" become void of definition, because who can truly describe the grief of losing a loved one? And how can we learn to navigate life when "I love" turns to "I loved"? Deuteronomy 32 and verse 7 implores a generation to remember the days of old, consider the generations of long past. This scripture directs a generation, saying, "Ask your father and he will tell you. Ask your elders and they will explain it to you." This scripture says to memorialize the past. There is a power and a blessing that coincides with remembering. And today, we are gathered together to remember my father, Reginald Harwood. My dad, who was the best storyteller of all time, often began a story with "remember when," or "do you remember that one time?" And he would just try to hook you in to listen to whatever story he wanted to tell you. Memorializing the past, or remembering when, it will retell a memory from 20 years ago, making that memory come alive in present tense. A memory does not have to remain in the confines of the past, but it can live again today, and it can live again in the future. All you have to do is share a story like we are today and share your love with someone. Today, I remember a father who read, "Where's the bear?" to his little girl. Where's the bear when the wind blows cold and the bird and the beaver and the bee? Bears find sleeping good in the cave in the wood, and birds have a nest in the tree. Beavers stay warm and nice under the ice, built of a lodge built of branches and sticks, and bees keep alive in a comfortable hive and sip on the honey day's mix. Where's the Bear is a book about where animals live during the winter months. It sang it with me throughout my childhood, my teenage years, and throughout adulthood. With sound effects and all, as you can imagine, he was still reading to his little girl, who just so happened to be in her 30s with children. Memory, my dad, in the province of Ontario. Who can really put some people to flight, amen? That literally pulled us from the darkness. Where would we be without? They would enter into a Harwood competition. And if Jamie and Angel were in another boat across the lake, he would provoke them. Not that he ever provoked anyone before, but he would provoke them by saying, "Aha, we caught another one, and another one." And one thing I know is that Grampy is very proud of you both, and he prayed for you all of the time and for the ministries that God has for both of you. Jonna and Ethan, I know my dad prayed for you often and never wavered in his love for you. His last visit that we all had together, my dad looked around the room and he said, "Jonna," and I said, "Dad, she's on her way," because he wanted his family with him. Jubilee and Levi will grow up hearing stories about how excited you were when you found out you were going to be a grampy again. I will never forget you crying on the phone saying, "Jubilee. Wow, what a beautiful name." Mom, you were the love of his life, his confidant, his travel companion, his ministry partner, and from your first date eating pizza when my dad was trying to impress you by eating a piece of pizza with a fork and a knife, which you soon learned was not his normal, to you standing by his side during the most difficult season of both of your lives, your love never wavered. Grammy, if you ever watch this, how many times did you say, "Oh, Reggie," in your life? And how many beautiful moments did you have with your son throughout the years? One of my dad's favorite memories was when you and Aunt Debbie were baptized on the same night in Jesus' name. He would tell that story with so much excitement and pride. Uncle David, I know that my dad loved you so much. He loved hearing you praying and testifying about the goodness of God. And when we were praying together in my dad's room just last month, when Uncle David started speaking in tongues, both Michael and I, we shot up. We were like, wow, he has such a strong, powerful voice. But I know that my dad loved tormenting you with Bullwinkle growing up. But I know, or I hope, that he did it out of love. There's a multiplicity of memories we could share today, but time will not permit in this venue. We are here to remember and honor my father, Reginald Harwood, a man of integrity and love, a man who lived life to the fullest. He was more than a loving father. He was a son, a brother, a committed husband, a lifelong friend, dedicated pastor, a fishing buddy, and an unwavering faith in a broken world. He was also the king of Newfie jokes in Taxi Cab Tales, which I know Sister Brown has heard her share of Newfie jokes in her life. You literally could not escape Reg Harwood's infectious laugh and his charming greeting, "Buddy! Hey, buddy! Hey, buddy!" At ABI, I had a professor who hated being called buddy, and my dad was coming to visit me, and I said, "Dad, please don't call, you know, this minister buddy." And what does dad do? "Hey, buddy, I'm Angela's dad." And I was like, oh, no, why'd I even say anything? And if you were one of the many to go on a fishing trip with my father, you always came home with a story. A story about the fish that got away, or a story about the boat motor breaking down in the middle of the lake again, or a story about a near-death experience. My dad always gave people something to talk about. He was an artisan of stories, and he created memorable moments out of thin air. More than anything, he loved the Lord with everything in him. I would wake up to the sound of him praying, and I saw him reading and studying the Word of God every single day without exception. I'm not exaggerating. He read it every single day. His ardent love for the things of God ignited a passion inside of me, and I am eternally thankful for his investment in my life. The masterful messages my dad preached will not be silenced because he has been transported into glory. But the intonations of one Lord, one faith, and one baptism will be a resounding sound from our pulpits. The wisdom he instilled in his family will bear fruit in the generations to come. His love for God and God's word will be perpetuated in the lives of his children and grandchildren. My dad was the best soul winner, the greatest soul winner I have ever known, and he never met a stranger. Only eternity will reveal the impact he has made in the hearts and lives of individuals across this world. The task to condense a lifetime of memories into a 10-minute tribute is ineffable. Therefore, our memory of my dad will live beyond today. In our future memories, we will make sure you are there, Daddy. We will choose to remember when or remember that one time. We choose to evoke your memory and retell it and relive it and to make your memory alive in present tense. I honestly only have good memories of you, Daddy. Memories of you reading bedtime stories. Memories of planting trees and going fishing with my very first Snoopy fishing rod and camping on an island. Memories of Cherry Brook Zoo and playing the alligator game so many times at Crystal Palace and going on my first roller coaster ride at Marineland, which I was too short for, but he told me to stand on my tippy toes. Memories of hearing you pray and seeing you read your Bible every day without exception and learning how to love people without boundaries. I love you deeply and with all of my heart. I always told you you're the best daddy in the whole world, and you were and are, and you always will be. I never once questioned your love for me. Your love has been steadfast from the very beginning. You were the first one to have ever kissed my hand, and you reminded me of that all of the time, especially when I was a teenager. Almost every time you got off the phone with me, you were sure to say, I love you and Jesus loves you too. Daddy, you are not in my past only, but you will be in my future as well. You are in the green eyes of my son Levi. You are in the future message I will preach about the oneness of God. You will be in the middle of a family trip as I intentionally invest in my children like you invested in me and Jamie and Jonna and everyone else. I will remember the days of old. I will remember Where's the Bear. I will remember your abounding and unconditional love. I will remember the prayers you prayed and the blessings you spoke over me. I will remember you, Daddy, forever, and I will continue to love you every day.
Kind of had the same idea with his favorite story, because I opened with, where is the bear when the wind blows cold? And the bird and the beaver and the bee, bears find sleeping good in a cave in the wood, and the bird has a nest in a tree. Beavers stay warm and nice under the ice in a lodge built of branches and sticks. And bees keep alive in a comfortable hive and sip on the honey they mix. Where do toads go to get out of the snow, and the cow and the caterpillar and the cat? Toads dig in the mud till the spring flowers bud, and cows lie in barns to get fat. Caterpillars spin a cocoon just as soon as the leaves change color and fall. But the cat by the fire, where it's warmer and drier, has the best winter home of them all. Grampy will always be a part of my life, and I see him in the little things I do. At school, when we study trout, I'm reminded of the time when he took me rainbow trout fishing as a little girl. We were standing on a rock by the river when a snake came out of the water towards me. Grampy grabbed that thing and chucked it back into the rapids. And at my fisheries field camp, when my boat caught the largest 9-pound largemouth bass ever recorded on the lake, I remembered catching monster fish with Grampy in his boat, camping on an island in Elliott Lake. Although I don't think we ever caught one that big together. When I showed Grampy a picture, even when he was sick, his eyes still lit up in excitement. And at the same field camp, when my boat caught buckets of sunfish, I thought about the time one of us dropped our fishing rod in the water with Grampy. He dove off of the boat into the water and looked for that thing for at least a good 20 minutes. When he finally brought it back up to the surface, it had the tiniest little fish hooked on the line. And when we passed by Reed's Dairy in Belleville, I think about going there to get ice cream with our grandparents. There's a giant stuffed cow with sunglasses there. And if you press a red button, it moves really loud. We pressed that button so many times with Grampy that I think we almost broke it. And that's what I love about Grampy. He was so crazy and full of good stories, like the one where he visited Indonesia and ate a 100-year-old egg marinated in horse urine. He said the white of the egg was black and the yolk had turned red, and he was sick for weeks. And that's something I'll miss. I'll miss all the crazy stories, and I'll miss not being able to share my own adventures with him. But I know that he'll always be a part of me, and I'll take him wherever I go. So yes, today I am sad. But the sadness is dampened by a much stronger sense of hope. Yeah. The best thing about Grampy was that he loved Jesus. Yeah. And even though he's not here with us anymore, his adventures have really just begun. Yeah. Romans 8:18 says, "For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us." God has taken him out of his suffering and has given him a new life with no more sickness or pain. And I bet you he's up there right now catching the biggest fish you've ever seen. And I know that one day we'll see him again and our adventures will go on forever.
Well, this has been a roller coaster ride. You know Reg, and you do, up and down emotionally. You'll laugh one moment and cry in the next, and that's what's been happening right here. Wow, it's been amazing. I've been asked to take about 5 minutes to honor my friend. This is my 5-minute note right here, just to keep my thoughts together.
hearing about all this, about all of this, about Reg, and just some of the things that I knew and some of the things I didn't. I didn't know Reg for decades. I'd probably maybe a good part of 20 years, maybe. And I'm just looking up here. He was born the month before I was born. And so we had a lot in common when it came to just loving God and so on. That's where it stopped. All this other stuff about outdoors and everything else. Brother McLaughlin said, "Have you ever been fishing with Reg Harwood?" No, I didn't. God's given me great wisdom. But I am honored to just share a few moments. And thank you, Sherry. Thank you, Angela, Jamie. Thank you so very much, and all the family that's here and all the friends. I met Reg through an extraordinary young lady, and she's already been in this pulpit. She did the eulogy, and that was Angela. I had the privilege of teaching her at ABI, and obviously she was one of the brightest students that has ever gone through ABI, and she's just like a chip off the old block. Amen. And she spoke so highly about her dad. She said, "You need to meet my dad." I like to joke around. I like to have fun. She said, "You need to meet my dad." And chance took it to where Angela came and did a little work for us at the church when I was pastoring in Michigan, and then she came on to be on as staff. And then I really got to know Reg. We visited him. I got to preach for him a couple of times. Met a few of his folks there. Had a great time, and learned about him. Not to get yourself too far out there in the wilderness. I liked it when we stayed in the truck. I liked it when we stayed, you know, in safe places. My wife said, "Make sure that you talk about the fox." And there was a fox that he called out of the woods. I don't even know how he did that, but he just called it out of the woods, and they feed it bread. I didn't know foxes ate bread, but they do. That one did. And he'd just call, and he'd honk his horn. That's what he would do, honk his horn. And 5-10 minutes later, here comes a fox out of the woods. And he's feeding it bread. And as long as you fed the bread, the fox would be there. Then he said, "Have you seen a moose?" And my wife loves deer, and to her, a moose is just a very large deer. And she goes, "I want to see a moose." As a matter of fact, we were driving through Toronto, and she's going, "I'm hoping I get to see a moose." I said, "Baby, maybe not here." And so Reg knew that she loved moose, and one of our trips up here, he presented us with a big rack. I won't say of what, because I'm in a foreign country, and I'm not really sure. It was just a big rack, staying within the same topic that we've been talking about. And somehow or another, it got into Michigan where I was pastoring. Not really sure exactly how that all happened. But those are just some of the little memories that we have. He and I didn't grow up together. We didn't spend our youth together. But there's something about an individual who, when you meet them for the very first time, Reg Harwood was one of these guys, that you immediately connected with his spirit and with his enthusiasm. It's already been spoken about here that he was excited about everything, and he was. He was excited about everything. And if you weren't excited about something, he'll get you excited about it. No doubt about it. And so I will say this, that he was not a childhood friend of mine, but he was a dear friend of mine, no doubt about it, because we just clicked in the same ways. And I was just addicted to his infectious personality. And he was infectious. You just couldn't help getting around him and then being encouraged. Amen. So there are friends of length and of memory and childhood. Then there are friends of spirit and life. Amen. And that was Reg. He was, and it's, I think it's already been alluded to, Mr. Positive. And he was boundless in energy. I mean, I remember one time he was in Michigan with us, and I needed to get some cat litter because of ice and so on, and was having a hard time finding cat litter, believe it or not, just so that I could get some traction. So he's going, oh, I got a better idea. And I can't even remember what that better idea was. And we were in a dollar store, and so I finally found what I was looking for, and I brought it to the cashier. So I called across the store. I said, Reg, you got it. But he didn't hear me. He's just zooming back and forth, back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. Zoom, 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 back and forth. So I thought, well, he'll get tired in a moment. And I'll go out in the car. And I sat in the car for a little while. And he finally came back out. And I said, I got what I needed. And anyway, that was the end of that one there. But that's just, it was Red. Zoom, 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 zoom. And that's where, again, the bishop back here said, have you ever been in the boat with him? No. Amen. There have been so many memories of him in just the very short time that I've known him. We didn't get a chance to be together often, but when we did, it was always good. I preached for him. He preached for me when I was in Michigan. And he did a phenomenal job. He was a preacher. And he was a soul winner, as we all know. He was an influential person. I think the most telling evidence of that are the children that he raised. And I leaned over. The bishop, Brother McLaughlin, said extraordinary about Angela's eulogy. And I said, chip off the old block, no doubt about it. And the children that he had raised, Jamie, Angela, that he just was passionate about putting Jesus in them and anybody else that he knew, people that he pastored. Sherry, it had to have been an amazing life. Amen. And you are a lady of passion. I mean, you did crazy things too. You went overseas to Belarus all by yourself, you know, and kind of, you know, and it's like, really? Did I? My wife and I did, but I went with my wife. She was protecting me. So what a great pair you were. And Elliot Lake, and all the difference you made in people's lives. All I can say is this, that he's gone from our lives right now, temporarily. There's one thing about a Christian funeral, if you would say. Funerals are supposed to be sad, lots of tears. But when it comes to us, and especially a man like Reg, it's hard to have tears, hard to cry over something like that. Because we know that in just a little while, we'll see him. Amen. Just a little while, amen, we'll be together. Amen. There's a little song that, I'm not singing it, by the way, but I want to read it. Just a little while to stay here. Just a little while to wait. Just a little while to labor in the path that's always straight. Just a little more times of trouble in this low and sinful state. Then we'll enter heaven's portals, sweeping through those pearly gates. And the neat thing about it is, I think Reg is going to be right there waiting for us all. Amen. He'll be waiting for his kids, waiting for his grandkids, waiting for all of his friends and all the people that he has reached in his life. We honor a great man. Thank you so very much for letting me be a part of it. Family, thank you so very much.
Lord, everyone. Awesome opportunity to speak about Brother Reg Harwood. When I say his name, there's a litany of a whole bunch of things that go through my mind, and a lot of it has been said already. Let me extend my sympathy to Sister Harwood and all of the family and friends, and we're glad you're here today. How do I know Brother Harwood? Would you believe that he and Sister Harwood came to Sudbury for their honeymoon? And they came to visit us, and we immediately became friends. This is a bittersweet day. Bittersweet day, but it will get better. My husband, David, began to put things in motion for them to come to Sudbury as his assistant. They came as a team. It's hard to talk about one without talking about the other. So I will be talking about, I'm honoring Brother Harwood, but you just can't talk about him without Sister Harwood in my relationship with him. Brother Harwood was very effective. Oh, my husband began to put things in motion for them to come to Sudbury as his assistant. They came as a team. Brother Harwood was very effective in initiating an outreach program. It's been said here he knew no strangers. Sister Harwood's the same. They make me nervous. Sister Harwood was very effective in Sunday school. I say they each had separate ministry. However, they were a team. We probably had the largest Sunday school attendance when they were there. Yes, together they were a powerful team. They applied themselves and enhanced our weaknesses without overriding Pastor Brown and myself. They were an awesome assistant. Submissive would be a good word here. They worked in unity with us. Brother Harwood and Pastor Brown had very different styles of preaching, yet the word of God in Sudbury was declared with power and anointing. They worked well together. Brother Harwood and Pastor also became very good friends. They went fishing. They, you know, I felt like I should start with the little bear story. But he never tucked me in, okay? Okay, back to fishing. They went fishing and hunting together. They called these mental health days. They were professionals at annoying each other and calling it fun, like rustling in the snow, and they put a dent in my van somehow doing that. And I got home that day, they had this round thing trying to get the dent out of my van before I noticed. Brother Harwood would stop his boat really fast, and the seat that my husband sat in flew him backwards. And he was never going to go fishing with Brother Harwood again until the next time. And my husband wanted fly dope to put on in one of their occasions, and Brother Harwood gave him fish oil. So my husband put fish oil all over himself. The fresh air made those guys crazy. But they came home friends, smiling and laughing and waiting for the next opportunity to be out in the fresh air. But when it came to ministry in the church, both became sane and did the work of God with excellence, complementing each other's ministry. One day, Brother and Sister Harwood told my husband they were going for a drive. They were supposed to be going to Espanola. And they might have, I can't remember, but they ended up in Elliott Lake. And when they came home, they wanted a meeting with Pastor. I believe it went something like this. Pastor Brown said, "Before you say anything, you went to Elliott Lake, didn't you?" It was true. From there, the Harwoods expressed their interest in starting a work in Elliott Lake, and the rest is history. We were happy to send them, but sad to have them leave Sudbury. I can remember the first Sunday they were gone, I was sitting trying to play the piano and start the songs and all this, and tears all over the place. And I thought, dear God, what are we going to do now? But you know what? They started a work in Elliott Lake, and we survived. But Harwoods, they're pioneers. We're talking about a pioneer here today. Brother and Sister Harwood were pioneers in Elliott Lake. They started having church in their living room, but soon found a church building for sale. And with the Ontario District's help, it was purchased, Gospel Lighthouse of Elliott Lake. People began to come to church, repent of their sins. Many were baptized in Jesus' name for the remission of their sins. And some received the gift of the Holy Ghost. The whole gospel was being preached in Elliott Lake. Praise God. Harwoods were great workers in the kingdom of God and wonderful personal friends. We could talk church shop or personal concerns with each other and be assured it would remain confidential. As a daughter work of Sudbury, this did not happen often, but if Elliott Lake got a little tight financially, Sudbury would pitch in and help. However, it worked both ways. Elliott Lake helped Sudbury when times were tough too. I thank God for the time we had with Brother and Sister Harwood. When my husband was sick, the Harwoods and many others were there for me, and thank you. I remember being in ICU with my husband, and the phone rang in that room. A thought went through my head, that's either Brother Harwood or Brother Kirsten. They are the only two I know that could talk. We talked about him talking. Talk their way into getting their call into ICU, but it was much appreciated. Brother Harwood was truly a fisher of men. He would take new men in the church, or even old men, anybody would go fishing with him. And you took a risk going fishing with Brother Harwood. But he would lead them into a relationship with the Lord. And that was a good thing. In closing, Pastor Harwood, I have a couple of scriptures that I think describes your life. He probably knows them from memory. He had an incredible memory when it comes to scripture. Could tell you where it was found and all of that. In 2 Timothy 4 and 7, I fought a good fight. I have finished my course. He's finished his course. My husband finished his. Brother Peter finished his. These were friends of Brother Harwood, and they're probably having a grand old whatever today. Heaven's come alive, I'll tell you. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give to me at that day, and not to me only. And this would be the part that Brother Harwood would love. But unto all of them that love his appearing. Just one step, brother. Just one step. My next verse. For God is not, in Hebrews 6 and 10, for God is not unrighteous to forget your work and labor of love, which you have showed toward his name, in that you have ministered to the saints. And do minister. Your ministry lives on through your family and all of those. I was thinking while people were talking of the word influence. Brother Harwood influenced many people. There will be those that lay their head to rest and begin to hear your voice sharing the plan of salvation. This is Brother Harwood's question for you today in Matthew 27 and 22. Pilate saith unto them, what shall I do with Jesus, which is called Christ? What will I do, and what will you do with the man called Christ? God bless you. It's my privilege.
Mercy never fails me. In all Stand, would you do that? Would you stand? Let's worship God. Let's give him the glory. Let's do unto his worthy name. He's in this house to minister. He's in this house to touch us. He's in this house to lift some burdens. Come on, reach out. That's it. Just reach out. Let him do his thing. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I love that all my life. All my life, you've been faithful. Oh, hear me. The Holy Ghost wants to minister here today. Somebody is going to leave different. Somebody is going to leave one way or the other. You're going to make up your mind one way or you're going to make it the other. But God is extending love. God is extending mercy. God is extending grace. God is extending forgiveness in this house. Oh, worship God. Worship him. I feel a spirit of worship. Oh, the Holy Ghost is here. Take advantage of it. Let him bring a peace into your soul.
Oh, my. All my life.
All my life. And he isn't going to change now.
I wanted to say a couple of funny things, but I don't know if I should. Reggie and I were very good friends. Very good. There's only one Reg Harwood that would go deep sea fishing, catch a shark, put it on his Jeep, and drive up through Halifax. He and I had a fishing trip. We had more than one. He always got the biggest. But we had a fishing trip, my wife, and it was just a little, you could almost jump across the stream. And we were coming up in the boat, I think it was a motorboat. And he was standing up. So I was going to have a little fun with him. I guess I must have been piloting the thing. And give it a little shot. We ended up flipping the boat. He under it on this side and me under it on this side. He laughed. He never got over laughing about us baptizing each other. I appreciate everything I've heard. Beautiful. Sister Angela, you are awesome. And this man has a jewel. And this young lady, you did such an exceptional job. And there's not one of you had to lie about him. Amen. Let's go to Romans 5. And while you're finding it, Sister Sherry, we offer you condolences. Jamie and Angel, or Angela, I made sure I'd write that down right because I'm always saying Jamie and Angel. And your grandchildren, we offer you our condolences. And David, Regis' brother, take these condolences back to your mother for us. Romans 5, let's stand. And yeah, you're standing. Let's read while you're standing. That's what I was going to say. Read while you're standing because you're going to be sitting for the next 20 or 40 or 50 or 60 or minutes. I'm going to do my best to honor the fact that even cushioned seats, after you've been sitting on them for an hour or more, can become uncomfortable. Romans 5:1, for every high priest taken from among men is appointed for men in things pertaining to God, that he may offer both gifts and sacrifices for sins. He can have compassion on those who are ignorant and going astray, since he himself is also subject. Did I say Romans 5? That's before Hebrews, isn't it? We may get back to that. But when I started reading, I said, something's not right here. Okay, one more thing I was going to say about Reg and me. We had more in common than you will ever know. Both of us, ADHD uppercase. And when you get a combination like that together, you're on a trip. Romans 5, therefore, having been justified, now notice, having been justified by faith, we should have peace. What? Did I read? We have peace. We have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Through whom? Everything's through him. They say, you guys preach about Jesus all the time. Who better would we preach about? He's the Alpha and the Omega. He's the beginning and the end. He's the first and the last. He's coming back. And so, through whom also we have access by faith into the grace in which we stand and rejoice in hope of the glory of God. Now, I want you to notice the word hope. We'll be talking about that. And not only that, but we also glory in tribulation. Now, when you get the Holy Ghost the right way, you're going to be able to deal with some things. You're going to be able to deal with some disappointments, some hurts, and setbacks, and keep smiling. All right. Amen. And so, and not that, not only that, but we also glory in tribulations, knowing that tribulation produces, this is New King James Version for all of you that might misunderstand what he's saying, knowing that tradition or that tribulation produces perseverance, and perseverance, character, and character, hope. Now look at verse 5. Now hope does not disappoint, because the love of God has been shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which was given to us. Oh, my friend, when you get this Holy Ghost in your life, when you get this Holy Spirit in your life, it will change the way you think. It will change the way you talk. It will change the way you face life. Father, I thank you for your word. I thank you for your Spirit that's in this house today. The liberty, the freedom of the Spirit. Lord, you're about to set somebody free. You're about to give somebody a new hope. You're about to take somebody on a new road. Let it be. Let it be in the name of Jesus. Amen. And you may be seated. I am anticipating a celebration beyond what we're used to, and it's happening. It is happening in the midst of tears. My. I knew this man's faith. He knocked on every door in Elliott Lake and probably over and over a few times. He was a soul winner. He loved God. Now hear me. This windmill is getting dry. What I was going to say now. I want to talk, first of all, the Bible said in Romans 5 and 1, King James, Old King, and hope maketh not ashamed. Does not disappoint us. Because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given to us. Now, God will forgive you of all shame. He will forgive you and me of all shame. And when we get in a situation where we may sort of be tempted to do something we shouldn't, the Holy Ghost in us will say, no, no, don't go that way. Don't say that. Don't do that thing. This Holy Ghost is powerful. Oh, I'm getting ahead of myself, but let me tell you what it is. It's Christ in you. Not a second, not a third. It's Christ in you. The hope. Oh, I've got a hope. There's a land that's better. Oh, God, have mercy. Pastor looked at his watch and the little guy said, Dad, what does that mean? He said, nothing. At the outset of this message, Jesus Christ on Calvary. Well, let me back up. Shame generates a sense of guilt and condemnation, thus causing deep despair. That's what shame will do. You ever been there? Don't raise your hand. But I can tell you, I've been there. And I know what that feeling is. But my friend, when you come in contact with God Almighty and He transforms your life and He turns you around, He will strip you of shame. He will strip you of guilt. He will strip you of condemnation. You know what I felt when I was in the office, brethren? I felt like this is more like an evangelistic service than a memorial service. I felt that in my spirit because the Holy Ghost has already witnessed to me that He's ready. He's ready to do something for somebody that's been struggling, that's been wondering, that's been hoping. Will it ever change? I tell you, you turn it over to Jesus and you'll smile the rest of the day. God have mercy. Isaiah 53, He has borrowed, carried our, help me here, get me on the right. He has, sorrows and carried our grief. Now, I should have wrote it down. You got it up there? Maybe I didn't give it to them. Surely He has carried our sorrows and bore our griefs. We esteem Him stricken, smitten of God and afflicted. But He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. His stripes were for our healing. I'm going to give myself a little disclaimer here. Don't anybody walk out here and say he's getting too old to preach because he couldn't even talk. Come on. All right. It's new birth. This is where it begins. It is new birth. And by the way, I know what I was going to say a while ago. I feel like I'm preaching a message that Reg would want preached. He would want it preached. So I'm preaching in his stead this morning and this afternoon. And being dead, he's still speaking. And when he's cold and long ago, his testimony will resonate. It will reverberate We have people from New Brunswick here tonight, today. We thank you. We have people from south of the border. Thank you for coming. We have pastors from across Ontario. Thank you for being here. We're celebrating. We're celebrating victory. We're celebrating victory. We are celebrating victory. John 3, 1 to 5. Nicodemus said, we know you're a good guy. You're a good teacher. Nicodemus, Jesus got right to the point. Except the man be born again, he's not going to see the kingdom. Except the man be born from above. Nicodemus said, how's that going to happen? How am I ever going to get back in my mother's womb? I'm 40 or so years old. Jesus said, you don't understand what I'm saying. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, but that which is born of the spirit is spirit. Marvel not, marvel not, marvel not that I said you must be born again. And he made it very clear. Except a man, indisputable, irrefutable, undeniable, except a man be born of the water and the spirit, he can't enter the kingdom. He won't see it. Now, I told Brother Jamie in the office, said, I have a feeling I am going to be preaching a message, funeral message, memorial, that I have never preached in this direction before. But I feel it so strong. God wants to turn somebody around. I said, God wants to turn somebody around. Hallelujah. Amen. Romans 6, 1 to 6 says, buried with him in baptism. Buried with him, not them. Buried with him. Let me tell you, water baptism in the name of Jesus, it washes your sins away. I said it washes your sins away, so far away that God will never remember them again, as long as you just walk in love and worship him. You know what else that he said there when you're buried with him? You know what else he said? You're going to rise to be the same old creature you always was. Is that what it says? Is that what it says? What does it say, Brother Mitch? Walk. Walk. You used to sing it. There's a new man walking in my shoes. He doesn't do the things I used to do. This new man, my Lord, he can turn you around. He can take. He can take the mystery out of your life and become a mystery in the spirit. God. All right. Romans 8 and 24, we're saved by hope. We are saved by hope. He said, hope that is seen is not hope, because if I see it, what am I hoping for? But he said, if I don't see it, with patience, I'm going to wait. Because let me tell you, my friend, there's going to be a resurrection. There's going to be a resurrection. Brother Reg is going to come out of the grave. I've got a few loved ones over there. I'm going to see again. There shall be a resurrection. Titus 1 and 2, in hope of eternal life. There it is again, which God promised before the world began. Want to know where this goes back? It goes way back before there was a world. God said there's going to be eternal life. There's going to be eternal life. Amen. There's going to be eternal life. There's going to be eternal life. Hallelujah. My. Which God promised. Colossians 1 and 27. The riches of the ages
among the Gentiles is Christ in you, the hope of glory. I cut it down. That's what it's saying. The riches of the inheritance of the Gentiles, it's Christ. It's Christ in you, the hope. Hope is recorded 54 times in the Bible, and in our text, it means confident expectation. You know, we can say, well, I hope, and it doesn't mean much. It can be negative. Would you use that master's degree to help me here? But the hope that he's talking about, confident expectation. I know that I shall see him. Jesus put it in my will to reach the New Jerusalem. Each step is a thrill. My God. Let me get my breath. Worship God. We have a sure anchor in an unsure world. You have to think, will your anchor hold? Will your anchor hold? But we used to sing it. We have an anchor that keeps the soul steadfast and sure while the billows roll. Come on. We're connected to more than a church. We're connected to more than an organization. We are connected to the living God. That's why we get excited. That's why there is an excitement in this place. Come on. That's why we know where we're going. I said we know where we are going. Confident expectation. Yes. I want that to resonate. Yes. Confident expectation. And verse 2 of the 5th chapter of Romans. And rejoice in hope. And rejoice in hope. Yes. Of what? Of the glory of God. In this memorial service. Brother Ridge, you have left an indelible impression upon our lives, upon our mind, upon our spirit. Hallelujah. You made it. We're confident you have made it. The high priest of our profession wasn't offering ordinary blood as we know it. Right. Bible said it was precious. Right. Yeah. It was sinless. Yeah. Jesus, and I wrote these in my notes, Jesus was both the gift and the giver. The only high priest that offered himself. Precious blood. His blood. Oh God. Oh God. T.W. Barnes. Some of you brethren know who I'm talking about. T.W. Barnes said to young preachers, if you want revival, preach the blood. If you want people to get the Holy Ghost, preach the blood. Let me tell you, what can wash away my sins? Nothing. Nothing. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood. And he told Israel in Egypt, he said, when I see the blood, I'm going to pass over you. Yeah.
I think we need to resurrect some more of those old songs every once in a while. When I see the blood. That was God. That was God. When I see the blood. I want him to see his blood on me. I know, I'm trying my best. Don't anybody time me. We have a sure anchor.
Yes, we do.
It was his own precious blood that secured the hope that I'm talking about. His blood, not bulls and goats. They could only go so far. We're going to bring that in here in a little bit. 1 Peter 1:19. Let's see if you can get that up there. Quickly, 1 Peter 1, we were not redeemed with corruptible things as silver and gold from your vain conversation or whatever else, but, everybody say but, say it again, but with the precious blood of Jesus Christ as a lamb slain from the foundation of the world. Bible said in the verse 20, foreordained before the foundation of the world, but was manifest in these last times for you, who by him do believe in God that had raised him up from the dead and gave him glory, that your faith and hope. That your faith and hope, you know, sometimes we say, well, God, I don't know. I've done this wrong and I've done that wrong. Do you know that God has a remedy for every failure? I said, God has a remedy for every failure. My little children, these things write into you that you sin. And if any man sin, we have an advocate. Every once in a while, I have to run to that advocate and say, God, I messed up again. And gave him glory that your faith and hope might be in God. Seeing, isn't this beautiful? Seeing you have purified your souls in obeying the truth through the Spirit, being born again of incorruptible seed by the word of God. Born again, there's really been a change in me. Born again, just like Jesus said. Born again and all because of Calvary. Come on now. Yes. My.
Thank you, Lord.
Hebrews 6:11. Hebrews 6:17. The Bible said that back in that day, it took a promise and an oath. And the oath had to depend on someone higher than you were up the ladder in order for it to stick. And let me read it to you here. But Christ, being come and high priest, let me have to catch up with myself. Wherein God willingly determined to show unto the believers his indisputable counsel, confirmed it by an oath, that by two immutable things in which it was impossible for God to lie, we might have a strong consolation. I want to tell somebody, if you can believe this word, if you will believe this word, I promise you, you'll walk out of here changed. If you will believe what God has said, I promise you, Christian or not, you will walk out of here with a peace. Listen to what he said, that by two immutable things in which it was impossible for God to lie, we might have a strong consolation who have fled for refuge. Who have fled for refuge. Who have fled for refuge to lay hold upon the hope set before us. Yes. Which hope we have. Yes. Which hope we have as an anchor. As an anchor. Oh, God. It's an anchor of the soul, both sure and steadfast. Dear God, what a hope. Dear God, you know what? I can tell you this. If Reg was in here today, do you know what he'd be up? Yes, he would. Yes, he would. That ADHD would take over with that HG, that Holy Ghost. And I'm telling you, you would know the Reg was in the house. Well, Reg, we're going to see you, my friend. You have fought a good fight. You have finished the course. You have kept the faith. And you're just gone ahead of us, but we're on our way. We're on our way. I said we're on our way. I've got a hope. I've got a hope. I've got a hope. Which hope we have is an anchor of the soul, both that's steadfast, sure and steadfast, and which entereth into that within the veil. Where the forerunner Jesus has gone, making intercession for us. I don't know what you believe in. I don't really care. I say that respectfully. I don't say that bemeaning. I believe he's there making intercession right now. I said, I believe he's there making intercession. He's representing you before the judgment of God. He's representing me before the judgment of God. Amen. 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 I don't like to amen myself, but I will. God's word assures us that Jesus, without sin, offered himself a sacrifice for the sins of all humanity from the beginning of time. Hebrews 9 and 11. But Christ. Everybody say, but Christ. Say it again, but Christ, being come and high priest of good things to come. The theme of Hebrews is better. It's better. Everything's better. And so he has, he's a high priest of good things to come by a greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands. That is to say, not of this building, neither, everybody say neither. Neither by the blood of bulls and goats and the ashes of an heifer sprinkling in the unclean sacrifices to the purifying of the flesh. How much more? How much more? How much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without a spot? And you can put your name in there and you can say, he offered Arden Bustard. He offered David Harwood. Oh, he offered us tremendous forgiveness. Now, the Bible said, how much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God? I did a little study, and in the Old Testament, the life of the body, the life of the flesh was in the blood. But I want to give you a scripture in the New Testament, and it says, John 20 and 31, life through his name. Life, and when, When you take the name of Jesus in water baptism for the remission of sins, I believe that's when the blood is applied, because something's got to affect your conscience. I said something has to affect your conscience. Hallelujah. And when the enemy comes around and he tries to tear you down, you can say, Satan, you're too late. God's already dealt with that guilt. Now in 1 Peter 3:21, I am really trying to hurry. Turn that clock back around. The Bible said, the like figure unto baptism doth also now save us, not putting away the filth of the flesh, but the answer of what? The answer of what? A good conscience. Something had to speak to the conscience. Because I can show you from the Old Testament, every time they had a yearly sacrifice, they were reminded, you failed. Oh, God. Oh, my Lord and my God. But when he came on the scene, he took your sins, and he took my sins, and he took my stripes, and he took your stripes, and now I can have a clean conscience. Hebrews 9:9. Oh, yeah, let me back up to Peter. He said, by the resurrection of Jesus Christ. That's what took care of that. Because he paid the price for your soul. He came out of the grave. Victorious. 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 Over death, over hell, and over the grave. Come on, we have something to shout about. We have something to worship about this morning, this afternoon, because, he just robbed Satan. Hebrews 10:1-7 talks about the blood and sacrifices. And here's what they say, could never clear a guilty conscience. Never clear a guilty conscience. Jesus said, I've got an answer. I've got a remedy. Hallelujah. When you turn your life over to me and my spirit invades your heart, amen, your conscience loses its hold. Is there anybody here this morning or this afternoon? If I'm saying morning, it's still afternoon. Is there anybody can testify? I'm not asking you to stand, testify. But you can raise your hand and say, preacher, I experienced a clear conscience. I experienced guilt, God. Oh, I experienced it that night. That night, I remember my father was an alcoholic, and I remember his testimony. He would say, when I was under the influence of alcohol, I was afraid to meet the police the next day. I don't know what I did that night. My God, have mercy. But when God got done with Ray Bustard, what a change, what a change, what a change. Oh, my God. So worshipers in Hebrews 10:1-7 said, worshipers once purified would have no more conscience of sin. I'm going to tell you something. The devil's number one trick is to remind you of some past failure. And he'll even say, well, you up there for, you remember what you did? Don't listen to that old booger, they say down south. Don't listen to that booger. They said that, and I don't know who it was, but one of the old reformers, Satan came and gave him a whole list of things that he did and wrong, and said, this was against you and that was against you. And the man said, Satan, you're right. But he wrote through the whole thing. But the blood of Jesus Christ, God's Son, cleanseth. Not a one-time deal. My friend, you walk in the light as he is in the light, and you have a progressive cleansing. Come on now. Yes, you will. Thank you. Well, then you go to Romans. I can make up my own notes. I think it's Romans 8 and 1. Yes, sir. There is therefore now. There is therefore now. Oh, when that now came into my life. I said, when that now came into my life. There is therefore now. I don't care what kind of a devil you may have been. I don't care how far off you were in sin. When you turned to Jesus Christ, there is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. The law as written was completely against our ability to obey because of our unregenerated state. Therefore, it was taken out of the way. I'm telling you, Jeremiah 31 and 33, Hebrews 8 and 8, he said, I'm going to write my law on the fleshly tables of your heart. I'm going to take it off of cold stone. I'm going to, my God, have mercy. And let me tell you, he takes it out of the way by the act of new birth. Yeah. Paul Harvey says, page 3. Half a page. I'll be there. Colossians 2 and 12. Buried with him. Buried with him. I remember, and I've told this story time and time again, 1958, January 12th, when I was a teenager, 15 years old, I believe, when I walked out in the cold, chilly waters of the Bay of Fundy. And Pastor said, I now baptize you into the name of the Lord Jesus Christ for the remission. For the remission of your sins. Brother, I felt good. Yeah, it was cold. I jumped, but it wasn't Holy Ghost. It was that water was cold. But let me tell you, amen, it was snowing on the outside. But there were two or three of my siblings as well. Took on the name of Jesus. Oh, there's been a great change in me. A great change in me. I am so happy. Can't you tell I'm free? Praise the Lord, Reg. Praise the Lord, Reg. Did you see Reg shouting? Can you hear him shouting? I'm almost done, but don't tell your neighbor. Colossians 2:12, buried with him in baptism, wherein also ye are risen with him through the faith of the operation of God, who hath raised him from the dead, and you being dead in your sins and the uncircumcision of your flesh, hath he quickened together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses, not most of them, not some of them, everything you did, every lie, every curse. I don't care what you did. He took it all off the slate. And do you know what else he did? He blotted out The law that nobody could keep. Nobody could keep that law because of the flesh, but he blotted it out. No more. I remember dear old brother Dudley, C.B. Dudley. Remember a statement he made when Jesus went to Calvary. He said, the little lambs kicked up their heels on the hillsides of Judea and said, we don't need to die now. We don't need to die now because Christ, the Lamb of God, the sinless, the spotless Lamb of God, one sacrifice forever. And not only that, he spoiled principalities and powers. He made a show of them openly, triumphing over them. Like when the enemy won a victory, they would march their captives right down through the street that they overthrew, and they would rejoice. Come on, guys. Come on, guys. We got you now. Oh, my God. Oh! Wouldn't it be nice to have a parade around this place this afternoon? I said, wouldn't it be nice? I'm not saying we're going to, but it would be nice by waving our hand and say, I've got it. I know it. I've got it. I know it. It's real. It's real. It's real. After all of this, new birth, the Spirit of Christ has taken residence in our lives. And Romans 4 and 17 says, the kingdom of God is righteousness and joy and peace in the Holy Ghost. That's saying something. When you get righteousness, you're going to get peace. And when you get peace, you're going to get joy. That's how it works. Righteousness, peace, and joy. That's why we're acting the way we are today. You say you don't have any troubles, you better believe I've got them. And so does my wife, because she's got me. But oh, what a feeling. What a feeling. I'm trying to quit, and I know you're wishing I would, and I will. But I had to put up with you all for over an hour. I enjoyed it, though. I felt God quicken something to my spirit. And I am positively almost done. I felt in Job chapter 14, he said there is hope for a tree that has been cut down. Everybody say it can. It can come back to life and sprout. Even though its roots grow old and its stump dies in the ground. Here's what I felt God speak to my spirit. When my parents got saved, a spiritual family tree was sprouted. My brother preachers, right down the line, my daughter missions, the whole thing, the family tree began. And when Reginald Harwood became enraptured with this new birth experience, the family tree, the family tree was established, Jamie. And Angela, the family tree was established. I'm committing something to you this afternoon. I feel this very strong in my spirit. You're going to extend that family with your children, with your children, with your children. That family is going to be extended. I believe that Reg Harwood will face God with a clean record. Stand with me, please. Some of the nicest words you've heard today. Stand with me. I thought of the old song. I don't know how old it is. I'm gonna read some of the verses. I've journeyed through the long dark night, out on the open sea by faith alone, sight unknown, and yet his eyes were watching me. The anchor holds. Oh, I wish if I could sing, you better believe I'd. The anchor holds, though the ship is battered. The anchor holds, though the sails are torn. I have fallen on my knees as I faced the raging seas. The anchor holds in spite. Don't waste your time asking God to take the storm, because there's going to be storms. But somehow get a hold of that anchor. Get a hold of that anchor. He said, I had visions. I've had dreams. I've even held them in my hand. But I never knew they would slip right through like they were only grains of sand. But the anchor holds. Though the ship be battered, the anchor holds. I feel it so strong. I like this part. Coming to the end. I have been young, but I'm older now. Some of you can tell that. 70+. I have been young, but I am older now, and there has been beauty that these eyes have seen. But it was in the night through the storms of my life. Oh, that's where God proved his love for me. Father, your presence is in this place. Some of us are standing in the midst of grief. But we're not despairing. We got a hold of that anchor. That anchor that went behind the veil. That anchor that went where the glory of God resided. And we're not going to give in to despair. Speak, Lord. Speak as only you can. That's it. Just worship him a little bit. That's it. Just worship him a little bit. Let God speak to your heart. Let God show you that you can leave here changed. You can leave your burden somewhere in this place. You can leave your hurts somewhere in this place. You can leave your disappointments somewhere in this place and walk out those doors free.
just raise your hand today and say, here I am, Lord. You see me, you know me, but I give myself to you right now. What was just preached, I'm going to believe it. And I'm going to make that one step towards you today. And you're going to do the rest, but I'm going to make an effort. But today we have a promise, amen. We have a promise of an unbroken dwelling place to be with our Lord and Savior in the air one day. And I told God the other day, I just can't wait to get to heaven to see my daddy. But God, help me to be as excited to see you. Because right now that's all I can think about is to see my dad again. But help me get to that place where I just long to be in your presence for all eternity. Amen. Hallelujah. Let's sing about that today. When we all get to yeah.
Thank you, Jesus. If you knew what was going to happen here today when you came in, you'd have to be God. When we come to funeral services, we have no idea how it's going to unfold or what's going to happen or whether it's going to be really short or long or maybe in between. But we've been in the presence of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. It's more than fitting that Brother Reg Harwood's pastor could get to preach Brother Reg Harwood's memorial service. Not only that, they've been very close friends all the way along. And a lot of Reg Harwood's ministry began from those initial experiences in St. John, New Brunswick. We need one another. We're fearfully and wonderfully made, but we're not self-made. We need God and we need the church. And I would say, Sister Sherry, Brother Jamie and Angela and Jonna and David and their families, God does such amazing miracles in families. And what Pastor Bustard was preaching about today, you do not have to remain mired in shame, in guilt, and in condemnation. Because I do believe those are key tools that the enemy of your soul is using in 2024 against our children, against young people, young adults, to live lives of regret instead of realizing the blood of Jesus cleanseth from all sin. Thank you, Brother Bustard. Thank you for reminding us the power of the blood that has brought transformation into our lives. Thank you to the Harwood family. You've got a great legacy. Let's live it out. Hallelujah. I happened to be on the district board when Brother Reg Harwood on York Boardroom on Dixon Road in at the Delta Hotel came for ministerial license. I remember that partial interview because Brother Harwood came. He didn't have all of his paperwork with him. And I said, Brother Harwood, you're not going to be getting an interview tonight. And he said, yes, I am. I said, no, you're not. He said, I want an interview. I said, no, you don't. It'd be better for you not to have this interview right now. He said, could I speak to the district board? It's Sister Sherry, you probably heard about that many times. That was very interesting. He didn't get his license that particular occasion, but later on he assembled the paperwork. But it was that tenacity that kept him going. Hallelujah. And it's that tenacity that's going to keep you going. Because, Brother Buster, everybody that's here is in storms. And I'd like to tell you that there's no more storms coming, but I believe there's a lot more storms coming. But we've got to know who our anchor is and realize it holds. Our anchor holds. There's food for us downstairs. We'd like you to visit with the family. Thank you for being here. I'd like to thank the ministers of the Ontario District for being here and supporting the Harwoods. Thank you. Your attendance is significant. Thank you each one for the miles you've driven to come and be here. Thank you for being a friend to the family. Not only that, when Brother Harwood was ordained, you came to Hikes Bay. You need friends to get through this life. Lord Jesus, we have sensed your presence. We have heard your word. Thank you for it. Thank you for the Harwood family. Thank you for this congregation, this church. Thank you for friends that have assembled today. And Lord, we're believing as we leave this place, we will entertain your presence, reflect upon your word, and realize we can make it. We can live for you. We can serve you. Our lives can begin anew and afresh today. We can begin our journey with you, to you. Strengthen us. Protect us. Shield us. Surround this family today with your love and mercy. Thank you for the visitation of your divine presence today. In Jesus' name, we want you to bless the food that we're about to partake of and our time of fellowship in the lower auditorium. And we'll thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you.